So the data persistence course is coming to an end, and as the last chapter, I would like to talk about big data processing, particularly the MapReduce framework. This is a bit different to the traditional database systems, but we will see we can also realize SQL queries using this framework. This is also acting as a teaser, this chapter, for the upcoming distributed data management lecture I'm offering every other summer term. So when you're talking about big data, we can refer to multiple aspects of it. One is the pure data management level, where we have to provide algorithms and systems in order to handle big data. And there's also the side of why would we process big data? And the answer is, well, we want to obtain insights. Traditionally, scientific discovery was done using experiments. So this has been done since thousands of years. And then people started developing theory, some hundred years ago already, to model the observations they did in the real world into theory to derive further properties or further deeper theory. Later, only a few decades ago, there was the possibility to do heavy calculations and simulations in order to obtain insights. And now in the big data age, we have the possibility to do data-driven scientific discovery. So we can analyze huge amounts of data in order to learn interesting aspects. You can think of many algorithms that are interesting to apply on big data. For instance, if you're looking at a Google search engine or any search engine, and you have a huge corpus of HTML documents, you can compute what is the term which appears most frequently. So what is the frequency of an occurrence of a term? How often do pairs of terms appear together? What are the most influential websites? Then looking at real-time information on Twitter, what are the trending topics? Or which keywords are most frequently used by users? The paradigm here, or the goal, is to discover knowledge. So you're accumulating data, and then you want to analyze it to find some interesting insights. People are not doing this because they are only interested in insights, but of course these insights should also lead, in many cases at least, to making money. For instance, if you're looking what Google or other search engines are doing, or Twitter, they want to understand users' interest in order to make a smart ad placement, to advertise products, right, and to make money. So when we talk about big data, of course, we mean, first of all, large amounts of data. And if you're looking at the example again, Google, they have several billion websites indexed. And here we're talking about terabytes of data. And it's not only websites, but also we have YouTube videos, images, user profiles, your email stored in Gmail, and so on. And of course, what people often not really estimate well is the amount of internal data such companies have to handle. For instance, HTTP server access logs for intrusion detection and other important aspects. On the right-hand side, you see the interesting picture. It seems to be a picture showing the Google server in the year roughly 1999. So you see already there are multiple motherboards, multiple hard disks here, and a lot of network cables, and one huge switch. But now if you're comparing this, which looks kind of impressive maybe back in the years, but if you're comparing this to the Google infrastructure currently, this is like a very tiny setup. So if you're looking at some numbers, and already these are 6 years old now, 7 years old, from year 2014, then Google had an index or data of 15,000 petabytes, which is 15 exabytes. Facebook, 300 petabytes. eBay, 90 petabytes. And then here you have numbers about the amount of data which is processed per day. So in Google we have 100 petabytes processed per day, and of course you cannot do it with a single server, or even not with 10 servers, right? You have to have a huge infrastructure to handle such large amounts of data. To illustrate how big a petabyte is, here you see this little dot here, there. It's not a dirt on your screen. This is like an intended dot on this slide. This represents a gigabyte. This one here represents a terabyte. And here we see only a part of the depiction of one petabyte. So this is really a lot of data. If you don't believe it, here you see it visually, how big a petabyte is. This is one part of the challenge in big data processing. And this big data challenge is often described by the four V's. The first one, as we have seen, is volume. So there's a lot of data that needs to be processed. But that's not all. There's also the dimension of velocity. That means data dynamics. Data is changing all the time and it's growing. The next one is called variety. Data and data sources are heterogeneous. So you have images, you have clicks of users on links, you have Twitter tweets, you have HTML documents, and so on. Last, we have variety, which means information can be wrong or right. So you don't really know in many cases if the information you see, for instance, on the internet, is really correct, right? And these together, and in the meantime, people came in a very creative way up to propose one or more of these V's, but these are the initial four V's of the big data challenge. So what are the problems and consequences of these large amounts of data? So we will focus here in this remaining part of the lecture only on the volume, so the large amount of data. So let's say you have a hard disk which is able to keep a file which is 10 terabyte big. Yeah, so it's one file. And now we want to analyze the data. For instance, there are Twitter tweets and we want to find the current trends within that 10 terabyte file. So now, assuming we have a hard disk which can store this 10 terabyte, and this hard disk has a sequential read rate of 100 megabytes per second. Yeah, you can also say it's low. I have one with 200 megabytes per second, but this will be the same kind of order of magnitude, 100 or 200 megabytes per second. So let's assume 100 megabytes per second, then reading that file alone without even analyzing it takes 27 hours. Right, so if you assume that this 10 terabyte of data was produced within like a day, you need another full day or more than that in order to process it. And then you have already the new data from the other day, right? So you have to be much faster. Otherwise, you will never reach some real-time data analysis, for instance, which would be optimal, of course, in the scenario of Twitter. So what can we do? Well, we can buy more hardware. One way to do this, you're buying many more machines. This is called horizontal scaling. And these machines can be, let's say, normal server machines, not like your home PC, but there could be like some few thousand euro expensive servers. The other way you can do this is vertical scaling. So you're investing in a heavy single server and you're really equipping it with more RAM, more CPUs, and more and larger disks, and so on. Yeah, so it's a PC or it's like a server on steroids. As opposed to the horizontal scaling, we can add like reasonably normal machines, let's say. Now let's assume you're doing the horizontal scaling. That's also what we assume in this lecture now. We want to look at how data centers are handling this. And we are not looking for the case where we can vertically scale to fit petabytes of data. Somehow this is limited in scalability, whereas here, if the algorithms And so your tasks are fitting this. You can scale by adding more and more machines like the data centers like Google or Amazon are doing. And then you end up with these pictures. Here's a depiction of Google, one of Google data centers. Now they're offering, since some years, something which is similar to Google Street View. Here you have a data center street view, if you want to call it like this. So you can walk around in a Google data center. And they have multiple of these, and there are so many machines in these racks and switches and network cables and so on. So this is like a horizontal scaling approach. However, if you're buying more hardware, there's also the probability that they will fail quite often. Let's say that you have one machine at home and this fails once a year. Let's say there's a hardware failure once a year. The hard disk, for instance. So this means that the probability that your machine at home fails today is 1 divided by 365. This seems reasonable. Probably it's even less than this, the chance, but let's say it's like this, and then you're walking through some store and you're getting a new hard disk and you're fixing it, and yeah, well. Okay. Seems to be manageable. But now assume we're having N machines. And then the probability that today there will be at least one machine failing is given by this equation here. And if you put in some numbers for one, well, easy, right? Nothing, not really problematic. But if we go up to, let's say, 100 machines, we have already a 24% chance that today at least one machine will fail and we have to deal with it. And if we go to 1,000 machines, it's 94% roughly that today there will be a machine failure, at least one, maybe even more, right? And if you go to 10,000, which is a huge number, but it's also not unrealistic, looking at these huge data centers, in principle, the probability is 100% that today there will be at least one machine failing. And what are the consequences? Well, the consequences are that you have to have redundancy in your data storage, because if you have like some petabytes of data and you want to store this, and then there's one part of this data missing because some machine is failing, and then your data analysis will not be correct. So you have to have redundancy in your storage, and not only in the storage, but also in the data processing. Because if you're starting a huge computational job over 10,000 machines and this job is running for 2 days, because it's a very heavy analysis, and within the 2 days, as we have seen, there will be for sure some machines dying. And in case you don't have any redundant data processing, you have to really restart the entire computation. And guess what? It will again happen that during the next execution, there will be a problem and you have to, well, it's a problem, right? So we have to have redundancy in the data storage and also in the data processing. So you can illustrate this as follows. We have a distributed file system, and we talk about blocks like we did in database systems, but now these blocks are much larger. We talk about block sizes of, let's say, 64 megabyte or 128 megabyte, right? So it's megabyte, right? So these are really big blocks. And these are distributed over this distributed file system. So you have here one node, another node, so 4 nodes in total. And these blocks are assigned to these nodes. They are replicated and assigned to these nodes. And then data processing ideally knows where which block is hosted. And if you want to execute a certain query accessing, let's say, one table, one relational table, which is stored in these blocks, then ideally the system knows where these blocks are located. So to start the query processing, the task immediately on these blocks. As said, now there can be, of course, relational data. And this is something that we assumed all over the lecture. We have tables, right, containing relations. But if talking about big data, in particular for the variety V, it's not only about relational data. We can have JSON data, like here. This is something that you're getting from the API in Twitter, some huge files or huge streams of JSON data describing tweet information. You can have access logs. For instance, here you see which IP address on which timestamp was accessing which URL of your web server. And of course, you can have also more or less relational data, which is stored in CSV files, for instance, like this one. And here you see again our example from the previous lectures talking about professor names, employee ID, position of the professor, and room. So all kind of data you can see in such big data systems. These systems come with nice UIs often. Well, this is like an older version. You can see here there was like a file called raw1.txt of Twitter tweets. And this huge file was distributed over 509 blocks of these aforementioned 64 or 128 megabyte sizes. In this case, we see here some sample block IDs and the location with IP address and port of the servers which are storing these replicas of these blocks.